We are talking to the one and only Peter Kahn. For those watching, you should know that he used to manage none other than Robert Garcia. Robert Garcia, one of the best trainers, if not the best trainer in boxing. Tell me about being his manager. You're a young guy, and he's a young guy. So right. How old were you guys?
So it was 1996, and I was working for Don King Productions at the time. I think you can't get away with that now. And I was a co-manager, and so Robert came to, you know, we signed a management agreement. Robert came to Don King Productions, and you know, Robert was a phenomenal fighter. He was a smart fighter. I remember, you know, good-looking kid back then. Still good-looking guy, but good-looking kid back then. Great fighter.
Big personality.
Big person, smart. You know, the whole bit. The whole family. The whole family's like that.
The big G was there. Tell us about Eduardo.
What can you say? You know, those guys probably.
How smart is he? How much boxing?
Probably the highest, you know, boxing IQ as a family is concerned in boxing. I mean, if you just look at, you know, what they've accomplished and, you know, created over the years, from Robert to even the work they do with Fernando Vargas to where Mikey is, all the fighters that Robert's worked with. I mean, you know, they're a team.
Did you know back then that Robert will become one of the best trainers in the history of boxing making? He made already 12 champions, by the way.
I know. I had no idea, because I remember when I asked Robert back then, I think they had the family restaurant in Oxnard.
Yes, they did.
And Robert said he wanted to be a police officer.
How would he do if he was a cop? More police shootings, huh? Everybody would be off with a warning.
Exactly. I think no matter what Robert would choose to do, he'd do well at it.
Now let's talk about this. Mikey Garcia, Errol Spence. You know Mikey.
Yep.
You know Errol. Break
sure.
it down.
So I was thinking about this actually yesterday. Okay. And on a boxing level, Mikey Garcia is going to come prepared. They're going to have a great game plan. And he's going to go in there and try to implement what he wants to implement. No doubt about that. He's going to be prepared for everything that Errol Spence wants to throw at him. My only concern for Mikey is the size, because Errol Spence is a big welterweight, and he could be punishing. And listen, I was thinking about it, and for Mikey Garcia to go up and to... He hasn't won at 47, right? No.
He's never fought at 47.
So
he's fought at 40 twice,
right.
And he won twice.
So I give him credit. He's going up. Trying to go for that. What would this be? How many weight divisions now?
He's from 35 to 47, so two. Oh, that would be fifth weight,
right.
Champion.
So you know what? He's giving it a shot. I mean, it's worth the shot. Take it. And you know, not only that, but he's taking it against the best guy in the division. Arguably the best guy in the division.
Working with Don King.
Yeah.
The fighter he had then is, to me, the person that got everyone, a lot of people into boxing, Mike Tyson. He's an idol. He's an icon. Even to this day, he's still relevant.
Right.
And what was your favorite moments with Mike Tyson in life? Not boxing highlights.
Right.
What do you remember being around him? Like, your just little moments.
Mike's that kind of guy that, you know, when you say, like, people walk in a room and there's that big energy? I mean, that's how it felt. At least that's how it felt to me. I'm going to be 47. I was 22 years old back then, right? What, 1995, so I was 23. And I was there for Tyson McNeely, Buster Mathis Jr., Seldon, Bruno, Holyfield. But about Mike, just that presence, that's what I would say. It was just when he walked in the room, when he was there, there was no internet, there was no social media, there were no cell phones. The only way you could see him was in person, or in a TV interview or a newspaper or magazine. So no one was overexposed.
So he was larger than life.
Larger than life, because, you know, you had to see it. Now people are so overexposed that
it's hard to stand
out. It desensitizes you.
It's true, it's true.
So you don't feel that presence.
Yeah. How would Mike Tyson do against Joshua, Wilder, and Fury?
So I thought about that too. And I think, and at first I was like, oh, well, these guys are big, but then I thought about it, Mike fought guys their size. And I think that the Mike back then would be just as competitive. I think that punching power that he possessed was just so powerful that he overwhelmed everybody in his prime.
Why do you think Robert Garcia retired at 26? He could have fought till today.
It's a good question. I don't know.
Okay, we'll have to ask him.
Well, no. I don't know. I think maybe Robert had, you know, Robert's just really cerebral guy. And I think maybe Robert had, at least the Robert, you know, I haven't, Robert and I see each other, say hello. I mean, we haven't, like, kept
touch. Yeah, to sit down, yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I mean, I would love to talk to him. You know, I've seen him here and there. But I just think just that he always had another plan. I think he always had, you know, bigger plans.
Two more questions, I'm done. We're here in Vegas. Pacquiao Broner, give me your assessment.
I think that I think it's going to be a closer fight than people think. I think that what's going to happen is I think it's going to be closer than people think. I think Manny Pacquiao by decision, and I wouldn't be surprised if it was a split decision. I think that Adrian Broner's coming to fight. I think he's going to leave it all in the ring, and remember, it's a 12 round fight. So we'll see how Manny fares as he goes along, and we'll see if all those questions that people have about Broner are answered. Is he going to let his hands go? Is he going to sit there in a high guard when Manny applies pressure? Is Broner going to be able to use that counter left hook? This is what's going to make it a great fight.
Gotta see. My last question in this interview, you have a show on Netflix with Frank Grillo. Tell us about it. What's it called?
Right. So Frank Grillo hosts a show called Fight World.
You travel all over the world.
Associate producer on that. I'm associate producer on that show. It's basically like Anthony Bourdain, Parts Unknown,
yes,
but for combat sports.
That's badass.
So traveled the world, went to Israel, Brazil, Mexico, Thailand, Burma, and went and instead of looking at the culture, you know, with its politics and food and nightlife and people like that, this was looking through the culture through the eyes of their combat sports. And Frank was embedded into boxing in Mexico, into Muay Thai in Thailand, and with the top names in the sports.
Krav Maga in Israel?
Krav Maga in Israel.
Did he get his ass kicked?
Oh, let me tell you, you watch it. Masters of War was the Israel episode, and it was pretty powerful.
They wanted to teach it to me when I was younger. But I was like a jokester, and I was like,
right,
I have a gun. What do I need to learn this for?
Watch the episode.
So
watch
I never took it seriously, and I regret it, because I could have been a...
Well, there's that episode shows you with a guy with a gun, and watch how he disarms him.
You also work with Solano Rodriguez. You work with, of course, George. Tell people where to follow you on social media.
You can follow me at Peter Kahn, P-E-T-E-R-K-A-H-N, on Twitter. And I also have Chris Van Heerden, Emmanuel Tego, George Cambosis, Saul Rodriguez, and, you know, keeps growing.
More to come. ESNewsReporting.com. I'm Elie Seckbach reporting.